have become a sound in the grass or a clinking cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, I am none. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long, is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It's not puffed up. Does not behave rude. Does not seek its own. It's not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity. Rejoices in the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. And endures all things. Love never fails. But whether they are prophecies, they will fail. Whether they are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now, we see in a mirror, dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know, just as also I am known. And now, by faith, hope, love, these three, the greatest of these is love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13.
And for some of my other people that I know that also serve
Father, we thank God for you, and we thank God for all of your service. It's something special to be able to serve in the military and to give so much of yourself for the cause of your nation. And so we thank God for all of your services. And today also I want to recognize all of those who are giving of themselves in such a selfless manner. Those who are working in the hospitals and those who are working in these essential jobs to make sure that we all can have food on our tables, that we can have gasoline in our cars. Those who are just out here doing what they can, even in the midst of all of this danger, to be a blessing to others. We thank God for each and every one of you too. And we pray that God will bless you in a very special way. Amen? Amen. Come on, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Let every eye close and every head bow as we once again go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father and our God, we come to thank you, to give you honor, to give you praise. This is the Lord's day. This is the day we set aside to come and give you honor and give you praise. To worship you. For each and every good, each and every one of us. We're just grateful and we're just thankful for everything that you do for us, Father God. And we just want to take this time out to open our mouths and just say and thank you and bless your name, Father God. You didn't have to do it, but you did so anyway. And so we're just grateful and thankful that we just say thank you. And even as
lesson of this morning will come out of the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 10. Gospel according to Luke, at chapter 10. But before we get started, let's have a word of prayer. Our Father and our God, we come give you honor and praise. You brought us through yet another week of danger seen and unseen. We're just grateful and thankful for how you watch over us and even make a way out of no way. We acknowledge that we could not have made it thus far without you. So we thank you and we give you honor and we give you praise. Now we come to this Christian moment. We now pray that you open our ears, prepare our hearts to receive the word of God, knowing that if the word of God finds good ground, it'll bring forth much fruit. So prepare our hearts, Father God. As the word of God goes forth, let it bring forth much fruit, that we might, Father God, be able to go out and share the good news with someone else. It is by this name the world calls religious, Christian, that you have chosen, Father God, to be an avenue unto salvation. So we give you honor and give you praise. Now, let your anointing fall not only in this place, but every home that is represented on this line we are on today. Let your anointing flow. Father God, give this your servant a little portion that I might be able to preach a word to your people that would help to encourage them, edify them, and glorify them as the word of God. And surely, we'll give you all the honor and we'll give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen. If you have the Bibles in your today, I encourage you to open them to the Luke according to Gospel. The Gospel according to Luke. We're going to begin our reading today at the 25th verse. That's Luke chapter 10, beginning at the 25th verse. This is our reading. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, What is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So he answered and said, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, Who is my neighbor? Then Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell amongst thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a certain priest came down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at that place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him, bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and he sat him on his own animal, brought him to the inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out two denarii, gave them to the innkeeper and said to them, take care of him. Whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. So which of these three do you think were neighbors to him? Who fell amongst the thieves? And he said, he who shows mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. And just for a little while today, I want to speak on the subject of how to be great. How to be great. You know, over the last couple of weeks, I've been watching this series that has been on ESPN called The Last Dance. The Last Dance really tells the story concerning those championship bulls and how they won these six championships, two three-peats. And in that particular docuseries, it outlines the struggles of many of them, especially that of Michael Jordan. And I can recall during that period that me and the kids would always run around talking about how they wanted to be like Mike. And in fact, they would wear many of the same kind of clothing that he would wear, and they would especially wear those gym shoes. In fact, there are some of you sitting out here today, even though that was 20 years ago, still trying to be like Mike. Still going out there buying them expensive gym shoes. Yeah, including my daughter, she's one of them too. But let me tell you something. It is good to want to be great in life. And I would encourage each and every one of you to live your life to be great. But don't live it just simply trying to emulate someone else or someone else's success. But I encourage you to live your life being great by serving others. Even as we prepare for this Memorial Day, this is really what we are celebrating, is the service of others, not for themselves, but for others. And even as we give them their due honor and their due respect for the sacrifices that they have made and they are making, we are reminded that there is also a sacrifice that we too must make. For the Bible encourages all, not some, but all of us, to strive to be great. And in fact, we can by serving others. In fact, Matthew 20 and 26 says, whosoever desires to become great amongst you, let him be your servant. And so scripture encourages us to truly be great. We must be able to serve. Now I must caution you that this kind of service is not always recognized. You don't always get the accolades like maybe a Michael Jordan or somebody of that stature. It doesn't really matter what it is, acknowledged or not acknowledged. The fact of the matter is this, that God sees all and God knows all. And that means this, that when he sees us, as we give to others, as we do what we can for others, that God always keeps a record. Because he's promised us in the word of God that there is nothing in this life that we do that he will not reward us handsomely for. So the Bible encourages, do good. Do good to others. Treat others the right way. In fact, our Sunday school lesson expressed the very same idea, is that because we are God's people, that he expects us to hold up a standard by which he would be proud. And so he desires for us to do good to others. And even though we live in a world is so difficult now to find people to just do good, he still encourages us to do so, irregardless of what we may see or hear. We live in times of poor leadership. And because of this poor leadership, the country is suffering right now. So, the scriptures say this. Even if the leaders do not lead right, we still have an obligation to treat one another right and to do good by one another. In fact, this lawyer that we just talked about, he is really a practitioner of the scriptures. He is one that has to interpret the scriptures. And so they put him up that he might test Jesus, that he might be able to trip Jesus up somehow, somewhere. And so he asked Jesus the question, what must I do to have eternal life? And it was then Jesus answered the question for him and told him, well, you're the practitioner. You're the one who people look up because you study the scriptures. You tell me. What is it that the scriptures say? And he being the one who studied in the scriptures and who was learning, he began to explain to Jesus. He began to tell him that the scripture said, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your strength, and with all of your mind. And then love your neighbor as yourself. If you truly fulfill all of these things, then surely you shall have eternal life. Now I'm sure that this particular man didn't have an issue with our attitude towards God. But the scripture said he chose to justify himself. That means this. Many of them live with this attitude that they live the kind of life that God called them to live through the Ten Commandments. But the fact of the matter is, there is no man that was ever able to keep the Ten Commandments except for Jesus Christ. And because if you are guilty of one, you are guilty of them all. No man was able to keep them. In fact, the intent of the Ten Commandments was to show us that we couldn't do it on our own. And that in fact we needed a Savior. That's why Jesus Christ came into the world. God the Son took on the form of a man and came into the world. And in doing so, he taught us by precept and by example how we are to live our lives. So in justifying himself, the scripture says the man asked Jesus another question. And that question was, who is my neighbor? And I'm sure many of you might be asking the very same question. Who is my neighbor? Who's the one that I should be concerned for? Who is the one that I should care about? Who is the one that I ought to have concern for? Who is my neighbor? And I know if you were just to read the scriptures as it seems, you would think that your neighbor was simply the one that lived next door to you. But I'm here to tell you,
The neighbors are many more than that. Shouldn't we live in a time in which we have neighbors that live next door to us, but we have many more neighbors than just simply the ones that have an address that is close to the same address that we have. That in fact there are those in life who we do not even know what their addresses are. They are our neighbors too. In fact, it is all of those that possess the image of God are considered our neighbors. So that means that we ought to have concern. We ought to be willing to put ourselves out. We ought to be willing to go the extra mile, or we ought to be willing to do whatever we can to be a blessing for. But these truly are the neighbors in which God will hold us accountable for. The scripture says that there was a man who was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. And in doing so, he was attacked by a bunch of thieves. The Bible said that they had robbed him, took everything he had, including his clothes and hat, beaten him half to death, and left him there on the street. Left him there, half dead and bleeding and injured. Came back first. A priest. One who should have known God for himself. A priest, a practitioner of the scriptures, a practitioner of teaching, a practitioner of being able to tell others about the word of God. A priest. One who is looked up in the community. One who people give honor to for his position of priest was the first one to come back. And the scripture said that he went on the other side of the room, for he was concerned not about the man who was in it. And he went about his way. And I must say, some of us, we are certainly guilty of the same thing. Where we have gone past situations and we have gone past opportunities in which we could help somebody along the road, and rather than to help them, we too have gone on the other side of the street, rather than to be able to help them along the way. Now, I'll be the first one to tell you. You may not be able to help everybody, but you ought to be able to help somebody along the way. God has not placed us in the positions that he has placed us in. God has not blessed us the way that he has blessed us, simply for us not to be concerned about somebody else. That's how I come here. As you and me, we do whatever we can to help somebody along the way. If that means that we need to give food out, then we have a food pantry where we can give food out to dogs who need a little help. We have a benevolent committee here at this church where we reach out to help those who need help. And even through our convention, Progressive National, we often give that they too can give to those missions around the world to be a blessing to somebody else. It's not good enough to see someone's pain and someone's sorrow and see what someone is going through, and when you can, not refuse to help. We're obligated to help. Because if the truth be told, somebody had to help some of us along. Because we were so strong and so invincible. But we got where we are because somebody helped us along the way.
engage. The scripture says, after the priest came by, and the priest refused to help, the one who probably knew the scriptures the best. The Bible says, there was another priest that came by. He was a Levite. And this Levite who came by, he saw the situation, he assessed the situation, and he did the very same thing. He crossed the street and went past on the other side of the street so that he would not have to intervene. He would not have to investigate anymore. He just simply saw it as a time in which he did not want to engage, he did not want to get involved. Saints, I'm telling you, I'm not telling you every time you see a situation, you ought to get involved. But I am telling you this. When the Holy Spirit leads you to engage, when the Holy Spirit leads you to give a word, when the Holy Spirit leads you to have equipped you with everything you need to make a difference in somebody's life, you ought to make a difference. Because this is part of the reason that you have been birthed into the world. Just for a moment like that. How do you make a difference in somebody's life? Reminds me of our children today. And how so many of us look past them day after day. Not understanding that this is an opportunity for us to be able to sow into somebody's life a word of encouragement, a word to help them along the way. And I ain't just talking about your children, but I'm talking about children that you know of that is in need of somebody to help them along, children that you know of that you know are suffering and that are hurting along the way. Because if the truth be told, many of us who have received the blessing from others, many of them just knew us. They had no family obligation to do anything for us. Many times they weren't even friendly with us that much. But yet they were willing to get involved. They were willing to help somebody along the way. When was the last time maybe you picked up the phone to tell somebody, I was just thinking about you? When was the last time that you took a card and wrote a note, I think you're special, and sent it to someone who maybe was struggling along the way? When was the last time that you did anything not to cross the street, but instead engaged in trying to help somebody along the way? Scripture says it was then. A despised man came along. The scripture said he was a Samaritan. And if you know anything about a Samaritan and about this story, all the people involved were Jews. But the Jews hated the Samaritans. They hated them because they were what we call half-breeds. They were half-Jewish, and they would have something else. And because the Jews didn't consider them as full-blooded Jews, the scripture said they despised the Samaritans. In fact, in the area that they lived in, many Jews would walk many miles all the way around their town just so they wouldn't have to pass through. But that wasn't Jesus' attitude. But when Jesus had an opportunity to pass through Samaria, he went right through. And when he went through, it was there that he even saved some souls. One of the things we have to remind ourselves is sometimes our attitudes are not the same as Jesus' attitude. And if we're truly going to be the children of God, then we too must learn to have the same kind of attitude that Jesus had. despised by all of the full-blooded Jews. The scripture said he had compassion. It said that in fact, he went up to the man and began to tend to his wounds and began to bind his wounds and to put salve and medicine onto his wounds. And if that wasn't enough, the scripture said he took the man and put him on his own horse. He inconvenienced himself for the cause of somebody else. How to be great? The scripture says, if you want to be great, you ought to be a servant to somebody else. And in putting the man onto his very own horse, he took him to a nearby inn. Not only did he take him there, but the scripture said he got him a room, paid for it, spent the night with the man, taking care of him. And the next morning, he got up and told the innkeeper, listen, let the man recover. Give him whatever he needs. And he said, and when I come back, if there's any additional cost, he said, I'll pay. I'll pay whatever cost it might be. And then Jesus, he asked the lawyer, he asked this practitioner of the scriptures, now which of these was a neighbor? And I tell you, as I ask you the question, do you want to be great? Because if you want to be great, then you have to serve. You have to serve others. You see, there's someone out there who is in the same predicament as this poor man that was robbed and beaten on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho, who needs a little help along the way. Are you that person that can help somebody along the way? Are you that person that can help somebody who is in distress, somebody who is suffering? Are you the one that has compassion and can stop and be able to intervene in a situation maybe that seems like it has nothing to do with you? But because it has affected your neighbor, you see that in fact you must engage and you must do what you can to be a blessing in that situation. The scriptures encourage us all. We can all be great because we can all serve. So ask yourself, are you great? Do you desire to be great? Then let your actions be a reflection of your words. Amen. Listen, I thank you. I thank you for joining us here on today. And I pray that you have received a word from out of the Word of God that will help encourage you this week, help you be able to be a blessing to somebody else. Because when I think about it, where would any of us be if it had not been for Jesus Christ on our side? He came to deliver us when we were beaten and naked in the streets. He made a way for us. I know it. He paid the price on the cross where he gave of himself that we might have this opportunity to live your life. He did it for us. And he paid the price. He paid the price for our sin. For the ones we have committed, the ones we may be into even right now. And if by chance there is something that might have happened in the future, paid the price for it all. So I thank you, and I bless you today. Now, baby, if there's someone out there today who you might know you was a part of your sin, I want to give you an opportunity to give your life unto the Lord right now. All you have to do is repeat after me these words, and you too can have eternal life. Let every eye close, every head bow. Father, my God, we thank you. Bless the name of the word on today. And Father God, we come to the throne acknowledging that we are sinners. And Father God, we ask that you forgive us of our sins. And that we repent of every one of them. As we acknowledge Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. That we accept the word of God. That he was hung up on the cross. Buried upon the tomb. Rose on the third day. And even right now, he sits at the right hand of God. We profess our faith and trust in him and him alone. So we ask now, Father God, that you would give us this gift of the Holy Spirit. Father God, that we might live life that is speaking unto you. Amen and amen. And if you pray that prayer along with me, you too will have eternal life. From this point on, live your life in serving the Lord. Listen, once again, I invite you to go to our website, UMBC.com. There, you can offer only a few services. If you want to become a member of the church, you can connect to or give financial support to the church. You can do that. We certainly welcome you. Like I said, on our next teaching ministry, you.